अस्सलामु अलैकुम व रहमतुल्लाहि व बरकातुहू। अल्हम्दुलिल्लाहि अला नेमतिल इस्लामी व कफा बिहा नेमा। ऑल प्रेज एंड ग्रेटिट्यूड बी टू अल्लाह सुभानहू व तआला ऑन हिज ब्लेसिंग ऑफ इस्लाम विच सफाइज़ एज़ अ ब्लेसिंग। औज़ु बिल्लाहि मिनश्शैतानिर रजीम। बिस्मिल्लाहिर रहमानिर रहीम। इन द नेम ऑफ अल्लाह द मोस्ट बेनिफिसेंट द मोस्ट मर्सीफुल। सो आई लाइक टू वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन दिस 17th टॉक दैट वी आर हैविंग दिस इवनिंग। वी आर एट पारा 9 एंड वी आर डूइंग सूरह आराफ। And inshallah, we'll begin with ayat number 88 this evening. What we are going to be looking predominantly in this talk today will be the story of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, also with Pharaoh and Bani Israel, their attitudes at that time. But we'll begin with the people of Madian, and that's where we left yesterday when we finished ayat number 87. Now, people of Madian were really infamous for some reasons, and to them, Hazrat Shuaib alayhi salam was sent in as a messenger. Because people of Madian were known for their financial dishonesty and deceit, and they would cheat people. They would give them less weight, mix good quality with poor quality. And Madian as a city, which was at that time the financial capital. Madian was a financial capital because of its prime location. It was on a trade route which was connecting Yemen with Syria and with Egypt. So every trading caravan would pass through the city. And after the financial frauds of these people reached to breathtaking heights, Hazrat Shuaib alayhi salam was sent as a messenger to warn these people. And when he did warn these people, what was their response? And that's the first ayat that we are doing this evening with ayat number 88. قَالَ الْمَلَأُ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا مِنْ قَوْمِهِ لَنُخْرِجَنَّكَ يَا شُعَيْبُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَكَ مِنْ قَرْيَتِنَا أَوْ لَتَعُدُّنَّ في ملتنا قال اولو كنا كارهين. The proud leaders of his people said, "We will banish you, O Shuaib, and those who believe with you from our city unless you return to our faith." He said, "Even if you are unwilling," which means even if I am unwilling to return back. Now, people like I've just mentioned in the beginning, the people of Madian were known for their financial irregularity, and they would cheat people. And Hazrat Shuaib alayhi salam was sent in as a messenger. Now, there are two warnings given by the leaders in this ayah that you see. First is that we will banish you, and second is that we will force you to return to our faith. Now, Hazrat Shuaib alayhi salam didn't comment on the first threat, which is about being banished from the city. But Hazrat Shuaib responds to send the threat that we will force you to come back to our faith, which means meant the faith of their forefathers. He responded that even if I don't want to, I'm not willing to do that. What he's really saying is that the way of your forefathers and the way that you are following is a very unjust way. It's a way which is full of oppression, high-handedness under the cover of religion. So cheating people under the cover of religion, I think that's the problem, and that's what we need to keep in mind, that when we mix religion with business, and as a result use religion as a facade, but at the backside we are defrauding people and cheating people, this is such a serious issue that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed a nation. Not only that, first he sent a messenger to them, and what Hazrat Shuaib said over here was, look, I don't want to be a party to this fraud. I'm not going to be part of your team. Indeed, we shall forge a lie against Allah if you go back to your folds after Allah has delivered us, nor can we turn to it except by the will of Allah. Our Rabb encompasses all things with knowledge. In Allah we put our trust, and our Rabb will decide between us and our people in truth for you. And our people in truth for you are the best judge. So what Hazrat Shuaib alayhi salam is saying over here is that if we do not want to do that, if we don't want to do that, and the reason why we don't want to do that is because this is like forging a lie against Allah. And we can't do that. We cannot forge a lie against Allah, and making clear that this is Allah's decision. He says this is Allah's will. He's surrendering everything to him, and in the end, he's saying, I'm putting my trust on my Rabb. He will decide the outcome of this since he is the best judge. The leaders of those who disbelieve from among the people said, if you follow Shuaib, you shall indeed be losers. And that's the people of Madian are saying. In every age, corrupt people have always felt the same fear concerning the way of, of truth, the way of righteousness, and the way of honesty. And the fear that such people have is that they will not be able to carry out their commerce and their worldly activities with the, you know, with life without dishonesty and immorality. So they want that, they feel that this is part of our business. To commit a fraud is part of our business. And human beings are the same even today, if you think about it. People today even say, if we don't bribe others, if we don't cheat in our business, this is our survival. We'll not survive in this business. So what they really are saying is, if people use this as a logic, what they're saying is that dishonesty and corruption is what gives me my risk. My risk is not coming from my Rabb. My sustainer is not my Rabb, but it is the fraud that I am doing over here, which is actually giving the risk that I get every, you know, from life. Then the earthquake seized them in the morning, and the morning found them prostrating in their dwelling. Those who denied Shu'aib became as though they had not dwelt there, and those who denied Shu'aib, they were the losers. So their standard, the people of Madian, their standard was that worldly possessions, and they thought that worldly possession you will lose if you follow the message of Hazrat Shu'aib alayhi salam, the message of Allah. If you follow that, you will become great loser. But in reality, not following the message of the messenger, not following the guidance of Allah, not only did they lose this world, but they also lost their hereafter. He left them saying, I conveyed to you, my people, the message of my Rabb and gave you a good counsel. How can I grieve for the unbelieving people? So by not believing in the message and the good counsel, what, you know, at the end of the day, Hazrat Shu'aib alayhi salam says, well, this is your funeral. I'm not going to grieve at the outcome of this, to see this destruction of this city of Madian. We never sent a prophet to a town except we afflicted its people with calamities as misfortune so that they might humble themselves. So this is the way of Allah. This is the sunnah of Allah. First, Allah would create an environment which is conducive so people realize and accept the message. And that's what is being said in this ayat. Things which will make people conceited and proud, sometimes Allah would take them away from them. Sometimes Allah would send this message in form of a famine or in form of a plague or sometimes in form of a defeat or sometimes even in our personal life as in a business, in a kind of a business loss. So loss is inflicted. Now the purpose over here is not to put a pain on us, but the purpose over there is to draw the attention of people, to shift their attention from the worldly goods towards Allah. But when people do not wake up, and then a worse trial and a worse tribulation descends on people. And this worst tribulation and trial is the immense prosperity Allah gives sometimes. Huge worldly success, which will make people even more heedless and more forgetful from you know, of Allah. Then we changed the adversity with good fortune, so that when they had multiplied, they said our fathers had also had their sorrows and joys. Then we seized them unaware when they did not perceive. So the view of the misguided and unwise people was that this change in fortune, that they were having lots of difficulties, business losses, everything, was just, you know, these were just change of fortune. This takes place independent of our moral values. These are not things that are taking place under control of some law or someone is sending. So for them, in accordance to the moral law, this is just blind nature working. Just it's that's nature. And nature sometimes brings adversity on us and sometimes it brings prosperity on us. So we had our difficulties and we have overcome them. And now we are prospering. And these are just ups and downs in our life. Had the people of these cities believed and feared, we would have showered upon them blessings from the heavens and the earth, but they disbelieved and we punished them for their misdeeds. So people of Shu'aib or the people of Madian thought that if they strive for the hereafter, if they correct themselves, if they become honest, then the worldly prosperity and happiness would go away. It would plunge. Such people were assuming that they would lose this world in order to get the hereafter. What their thinking was that if we have to be a loser in the hereafter to get this world, and that's really not true. That is not true. Because historically, if you look at nations who have been just and nations who have been honest, they have prospered. Look at the glory of Bani Israel during the time of Hazrat Sulaiman alayhi salam or Hazrat Dawood alayhi salam. Look at the history of Muslims for nearly about 800 years. I mean, it was a very long civilization. Any civilization, mark my word, any civilization will prosper as long as there is justice and as long as there is honesty. The message is no. The message is this: no. This deen is not for the underdogs. Do not think that this deen is only for the wretched people of the society. You can be successful in this world and you can be successful in the next world. And certainly if you want to have a peaceful, a prosperous life, and if you want to even have a better hereafter, don't hanker after this world by compromising on the hereafter. Were the people of those cities secure from our punishment when it overtook them in the night while they were sleeping? Or else did the people of the town feel secure from their Rabb, from our punishment coming to them in the morning while they play? Do not feel secure from Allah's scheme, and none feel secure from Allah's scheme except people who shall perish. Never be complacent about Allah. Keep Allah in mind. Keep, you know, have that introspect. Keep checking yourself. Keep asking yourself, am I doing something wrong? Keep asking Allah for forgiveness for things which we have done, we know, and we don't know the sins that we may have committed. All the time, stay in a state of istighfar and tawbah and forgiveness. Is it not become clear to those who inherited the earth after its previous people that if we willed, we could inflict them for their sins, but we set seals over their heart so that they do not hear. Very interesting. At the end of the ayat, you see, we set seals over their heart so they do not hear. So once people develop this immunity for sin and transgression, every time they do another sin, a new sin, it gets easier. You know, the human problem is that we do not learn from the mistakes of the past generation. Look at the past generation, the losses that they suffer, and that's a reality in consequences to their own doings. That's what they did, and they suffered a loss. But in the end, Allah says over here, we set seal over their hearts so they do not hear. Do we hear from our heart? Well, people will say, well, what is Quran meaning over here? We hear from our ears. Yes, we hear from our ears, but words have impact on our heart. So when Allah seals the heart of people, all the good counsel, all the nasihat we get, the message of Allah that we hear, it has no effect on the hearts of such people because it doesn't really change their deeds. So whilst they may be hearing, like animals also hear, it doesn't change their behavior. And that's the sealing of the heart, not the ears. Such were the towns whose story we relate to you, and certainly their messengers came to them with clear proofs. But they were not to believe in that which they had denied before. Thus Allah seals the hearts of the disbelievers. And we found large portion of them untrue to their commitment. Most of them we found defiantly disobedient. So the lack of loyalty to the covenants and to the promise with Allah has unfortunately been the general trend of mankind. And this is there throughout history, despite the fact that history repeats itself, reminding us of the faith of the past nation, but not many people take heed from that. Now we're going to begin the story of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. Then we sent after them Moses with our signs to Pharaoh and his leaders, but they were unjust towards them. So see how was the end of the transgressors. So in the story of Bani Israel and Hazrat Musa alayhi salam and Pharaoh, the key message, the punchline of this message would be, for the believers, that you may be weak. And this is what Quran is actually giving. You may be weak today. You may have your own weakness, but really that doesn't matter. Or you may have an enemy who is very strong, very mighty, like the Pharaoh, but that also doesn't matter. This should not make you lose hope and give up. That's the first thing. Do not give up. Don't think your weakness and the strength of the enemy is something that you should actually lose hope from and give up. Secondly, those who after believing act like Bani Israel, they will also have similar consequences, and we'll see some of the ayahs relating to that. And Moses said, O Pharaoh, I am a messenger from the Lord of the worlds. Now, this is the line that's used by all the messengers. All messengers begin with this message, that this is not my message, it's a message from the Rabb. I'm just conveying it to you, I'm just passing this on to you, as has been directed by my Creator. I'm worthy of telling nothing but nothing about Allah except the truth. I have come to you with clear signs from your Lord, so send with me the children of Israel. Now, Bani Israel had been in slavery for the past over 400 years in Egypt under the Pharaoh, and they were the people who actually built these great pyramids. If you have been to Egypt and seen these great pyramids, a lot of people go there and they admire and they gasp, oh, what a civilization. Well, it wasn't what of a civilization, it was a civilization which was made by these slaves. It was the Bani Israel who were the slaves who made all these great monuments, and at a great cost. Now, in this argument that Hazrat Musa alayhi salam is giving over here, is you can see in this argument, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, there is no guesswork. Even the words that he uses are very precise. And these are always, when the Prophet uses these words, there is no presumption in that. Prophets are very extreme, you know, careful. They're extremely careful in what they say. And remember that Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, when he came to the Pharaoh, he's coming from where? He's coming after speaking with Allah directly. He was in the desert and Allah spoke with him and gave him prophethood. So he spoke with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then on his way back from Madian, which was in self-exile, he had been in self-exile for many years, he returns back to Egypt and he goes to the court of the Pharaoh and he makes this conversation with him. Pharaoh said, if you have come with signs, then bring it forth. If you should be truthful. So Moses threw down his staff and suddenly it became a serpent. Suddenly it was a big snake. And he drew out his hand. Thereupon it was white with radiance for all those who saw. The eminent among the people of Pharaoh said, indeed he is a skillful magician who wants to expel you from your land through magic. So what would you have us do? How was Hazrat Musa alayhi salam such a danger to Pharaoh and his kingdom? Now here's a poor man who's just returned back from exile from a desert. He's really a destitute person. He's part of the slave community and he's standing in the court of the most powerful and rich king. He just turned a stick into a serpent, and that is like almost like threatening the great kingdom that extends from Syria to Libya. Why such an alarm that he will drive you out of Egypt? He's only saying, I'm a messenger of Allah. Well, the reason for that is the ideology of Pharaoh. Ideology of Pharaoh was now being challenged. His lifestyle was being challenged. His values were coming under threat. And that's the reason why sometimes we do not understand why in West they feel so threatened by the hijab. A two-fit cloth, but that two-fit cloth is really representing a whole ideology. And that is the reason why you feel people very threatened by the hijab that women sometimes put on. Others said, put them off for a while, him and his brother, and send among the city gatherers. So the personality of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam was very strong. He was a man with tremendous personality. He was pure. He in character, he had extraordinary abilities. Earlier he had been trained as a royal member. He was a member of the royal family. Remember that he grew up in the palace with the Pharaoh. The current Pharaoh was of the same age as Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. And not only that, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam had earlier proved to be in the Pharaoh's army. He proved himself to be an excellent general. And now he had lived in the desert, a desert life which had made him a serene and a very kind of a pious person. And not just a pious person, he was an extremely strong person with a very strong personality, especially with prophethood. And the people of Pharaoh were filled with awe, because in their hearts they correctly recognized that the danger this man was bringing. They immediately recognized this man is not a magician, and this is something that would make them lose their sleep for a long time. Who will bring every skillful magician? The magicians came to Pharaoh. They said, indeed for us is a reward if we prevail. So now they are grueling at the feet of Pharaoh and saying, okay, if we prevail, what reward will we get from here? So all they are looking for is a reward. He said, yes, you will be among those who are near to me. So next ayat, the contest begin, the match is on. They said, oh Moses, either you throw your staff or we will be the one who throw first. He said, which was Hazrat Musa alayhi salam said, throw, and when they threw, they bewitched the eyes of people and struck terror into them, and they presented a great feat of magic. Even Quran recognizes, yes, that was a great magic that they had shown. People were terrified when they threw these ropes being thrown, which was moving around and almost looks like snake. And we revealed to Moses, throw your staff. And at once it swallowed all the falsehood which they had faked. So, you know, now you see the difference between magic and a miracle. So the truth prevailed and all what they were doing proved vain, implying that the act of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam was really a genuine miracle, whereas what was done by the magician, that was just a feat of make-believe. Thus, they were defeated and they were put to shame. The magician fell down in prostration. They started to do sajda to Allah. They said, we believe in the Lord of the worlds, the Lord of Moses and Harun. Now you see that nobody could really judge better than the magicians that what is magic and what is a miracle. Since they were the expert and they were the authority on magic at that time, they knew what Hazrat Musa alayhi salam was showing was not magic, that was not a trick. The Pharaoh said, you dare believe in him before I give you permission? Indeed, this is a plot which you have conspired in the city to expel its people from it, but you shall soon know. Now, the position of Pharaoh at this point in time was a very embarrassing position, to say the least. His team not only lost, which is these magicians, but they now even changed sides, and that was not good for his PR. And this was turning out to be a public relation disaster. But Pharaoh was a shrewd man. He didn't become a Pharaoh just because of his looks, right? So he thinks, what do I do now? The very people who were to defeat Hazrat Musa alayhi salam have now moved into the enemy camp. But it isn't over. So he comes up with a stroke of genius. And he says, sorry, this is a plot. You know, sometimes when things happen over here in our country, in ourselves, we say, oh, this is all the agencies. We blame the agencies. The agency is behind this. And so did the Pharaoh. He said, this is a conspiracy. I will surely cut off your hands and your feet from the opposite side, and then I shall crucify you all. They said, indeed, to our Lord, we shall return. You can see the impact on these these magicians. Till yesterday they were magicians. Suddenly they see this genuine miracle taking place. And they knew that they are faced with someone who can actually, be extremely brutal to them. And that's exactly what Pharaoh said. I'm going to cut your hand, your feet, your opposite side and crucify you. And they said, fine, we shall return. You see the simple point that these magicians are making? The simple reply that they said. They said, well, this too shall end. It doesn't matter. We were going to return at some point in time. We'll do it now. Our return will be there. وَمَا تَنْقِمُ مِنَّا إِلَّا أَنْ آمَنَّا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّنَا لَمَّا جَاءَتْنَا رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا وَتَوَفَّنَا مُسْلِمِينَ. And you do not take revenge on us except because we have believed in the signs of our Lord when they came to us. And then they do make this prayer, Rabbana afrigh alayna sabran wa tawaffana muslimin. Beautiful prayer. O our Lord, pour upon us patience and cause us to die in a state of submission. The simple reply says it all. What a super prayer, right? What a super prayer of magicians, that it actually not only is a prayer, but it becomes the words of Allah. You know, it's now recorded in Quran. What more the magicians would want? They are now recognized for as long as this world lives. Now, just note how true faith transforms people. You know, we always talk about the fact that change is so difficult, change is a very difficult thing, people don't change. So bold and so brave these magicians had become that they are now defying the very same king, you know, in front of whom they were meekly bowing down and begging for a reward just a few moments ago. so convinced of truth and faith that now they are willing to face the most serious consequences of their refusal. Now, this remarkable change in outlook and perspective, and here is a very important lesson for us to understand, that this is the difference between Iman, which is submission, and this is the difference between Islam, which is submission, and Iman, which is a matter of accepting things by faith. So Bani Israel had been Muslims. They had accepted Islam for centuries. They were in the state of being a Muslim. They had submitted to that. So they were in a state of Islam. But there was no faith, there was no Iman in their hearts. Because Iman transforms people in the blink of an eye. And that's how Iman transformed, you know, these magicians. When they saw this and they recognized that there is a creator, it immediately changed them. And the eminent among the people of Pharaoh said, "Will you leave Moses and his people to corrupt, to cause corruption in the land and abandon your gods?" Pharaoh said, "We will kill their sons and keep their women alive. Indeed, we are in power over them." Now, Pharaoh had sharp political acumen and he realized Bani Israel are his underdog, they are his slaves. And Musa alayhi salam needs strength. He's a man all alone. Without Bani Israel behind him, he cannot rebel. If he does, there's nothing can happen. One man rebelling doesn't make any difference. And what he didn't really realize was that this wrong thinking would become his Waterloo. This was his first defeat. Why? Because Musa alayhi salam was not depending on his people. He was not depending on Bani Israel. His dependence was on his Rabb. Never underestimate the power. Never underestimate the power of Allah. And Pharaoh made this gross, you know, he grossly underestimated the power of Allah, and it will come to hound him in a very short time. But Bani Israel feels saddened when they heard this, you know, that he's going to kill our sons and keep our women alive, and that would have been a saddening experience. And then the Prophet, then Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, comforts them in the next ayat. Moses said to his people, "Seek help through Allah and be patient. Indeed, the earth belongs to Allah. He gives it to those of his servants whom he chooses, and the best outcome is for the righteous." They said, "We have been oppressed before you came to us, and oppressed we still remain." He said, "Perhaps your Lord will destroy your enemy and grant you succession in the land and see how you act," which means how you conduct yourself. Now, so therefore, now a little grumbling over here that you can see, or you can see within Bani Israel. This is the first hint of inconsistency and a weak faith. Bitter attitude, you know, not having a positive attitude, having a very bitter attitude, having this self-pity. This is a sign of a weakness in character. But the hope held out by Hazrat Musa alayhi salam helped the Israelites, helped Bani Israel to overcome their weakness, and it certainly gave them strength. "And we certainly afflicted the people of Pharaoh with drought and famine and deficiency in fruits, that perhaps that they would be reminded." So during the time of Merimpet, who was the Pharaoh at that time, we see from history that there is a record of a major famine which extended from Egypt right up to Syria. But when good came to them, they said, "It's our due." And if calamity afflicted them, they ascribed it to Moses and those with him. Unquestionably, it was Allah who had ordained their ills, but most of them do not know. And they said, "No matter what sign you bring to us to charm us, we will not believe in you." This is what the, you know, people of Pharaoh are telling Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, that no matter what miracle you tell us or show us, this is not going to impact our heart. We are not going to believe in that. "So we send down upon them floods of locusts and lice and frogs and blood as a clear sign, but they were arrogant and were a sinful people. And when the plague descended upon them, they said, 'O Moses, invoke for us your Lord by what he has promised you. If you can remove the plagues from us, we will surely believe in you, and we will send you the children, we'll send with you the children of Israel.'" So they were saying, you know, when you are in a difficulty, you just take any support that you get, even to the extent of Pharaoh saying, let this problem be over, and, you know, I'm going to believe with you, I'm going to send the children of Israel. But what they did after that, when Allah removed, "But when we removed the plague from them and the appointed time had come, they broke their promise. So we took revenge from them and we drowned them in the sea, because they denied our signs and were heedless of them. So we know that Pharaoh and his great army that were pursuing Bani Israel, who had left on an exodus in the midst of the night, it was followed. Pharaoh and his army followed them, and then they were drowned in the sea. And for them, this was game, set, match, and now they are history. And we made the people who had been oppressed to inherit the eastern lands, eastern regions of the land, and the western ones which we had blessed. So that's a real blessed land, the land of Palestine. And the gracious words of your Lord was fulfilled for the children of Israel because of what they had patiently endured. And we destroyed all the edifices and towers of Pharaoh and his people. And we took the children of Israel across the sea. Then they came upon a people who worshipped idols. They said, "O Moses, make for us a god just as they have gods." He said, "Indeed, you are ignorant people." Now, the exodus of Bani Israel was from Egypt to Palestine. On their way, they saw these people, and these people were worshipping idols. So suddenly they remembered their Pharaoh. Guess what? This is what we call in English the Stockholm Syndrome. Now, the Stockholm Syndrome is to be in love with your tormentor. And this is actually a psychological condition. You fall in love with someone who's actually tormenting you. And they just wanted to be like the Pharaoh. They have now gone out of bondage. They know the Pharaoh has been destroyed. Now they want to act like him. So despite the great oppression and the great exploitation of Pharaoh, yet in the hearts and minds of Bani Israel, he was still a role model for them. You know, we know all these role models people make. We know their life. We know their character. Yet people make them their role model. And, you know, these people of Bani Israel wanted to adopt the culture and the way of life of the Egyptians. Sometimes people win a very hard-earned freedom after uncountable sacrifices and then fall into the trap of mental slavery. Does that sound familiar? It does, because when we see in our own societies, in our countries, we have all these brown saps. The British have left, but after the British left, they have left behind the slaves, and these slaves have now become the tormentors and the brown saps of people over here, of common people. Indeed, that which they followed is doomed, and all that they were doing is in vain and worthless. He said, "Am I to seek for you a deity other than Allah when he has exalted you above all nations?" And this is a question of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. He is surprised. He says, "You are the best nations and you still want a deity? Do you want me to ask Allah for a deity for you? And remember when we saved you from the people of Pharaoh, who were afflicting you with the worst torment, killing your sons and keeping your women alive. And in that was a great trial from your Lord. And we made an appointment, with Moses for 30 nights and added to them additional 10 nights. So the appointed time with his Rabb was 40 nights. And Moses said to his brother Harun, "Take my place among my people, do what is right, and do not follow the way of the wrongdoers." So this whole incident or this whole story is about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inviting Hazrat Musa alayhi salam to Mount Tur. And when he is leaving for Mount Tur, leaving Bani Israel, he left his brother in charge to lead so that there is no vacuum in leadership. He made complete arrangements, right? He made complete arrangements to appoint his deputy, give him necessary instruction before he left. So being disorganized, being careless, being carefree, that's not a sign of piety. That's not a sign of spiritual evaluation. Who could be more spiritually elevated than Hazrat Musa alayhi salam? Yet before he left, he appointed somebody to continue to be the leader of Bani Israel. And when Moses came at our appointed time and his Lord spoke to him, he said, "My Lord, show me yourself that I may look at you." He said, "You can never see me, but look at the mountain. If it should remain firm in its place, then you will see me." But when his Lord revealed himself to the mountain, he leveled it to dust, and Moses fell unconscious. And when he recovered, he said, "Exalted are you. I turn to you in repentance. I am the first, I am the first of the believers." He said, "O Moses, I have chosen you above the people with my message and my speaking to you. So take what I give to you and be among the grateful. And we inscribed for him on tablets all things, admonition and clear explanation of all things, saying, take them holding firmly, and enjoin your people to take the best of it. I will show you the abode of the wicked transgressors. So what we see over here, that, you know, the word take them and hold firmly. Holding firm means with complete conviction, with sincerity. This was the book being given to them. This was the tablets being given to them, which had all the guidelines. Like we say, we get the Quran. So what Allah is saying is, hold it firmly, with sincerity, with action at all time, in amal, in your deeds, straight to, true to these commandments at all times in your life. I will turn away my signs from those who are unjustly arrogant upon the earth. And if they should see a sign, they will not believe in it. And if they see the right path, they shall not adopt it as a way. But if they see a way of error, they shall choose it for their path. That is because they have denied our signs and they are heedless of them. So this choice of path, as Quran is mentioning over here, this choice of right path and the way of error, this didn't stop at that time. This right path and way of error will keep coming in our life throughout our life. We will be tested all the time, whether we make a right choice, whether we take the right path or we take the way of the error. And this is why we need to be vigilant. Those who denied our signs and the meeting of the hereafter, their deeds have become worthless. Can they expect to be rewarded except as they had done? And in his absence, the people of Moses made a calf from their ornaments, an image having a hollow sound. Did they not see that it could neither speak to them nor guide them to a way? They took it for worship and they were the wrongdoers. So the golden calf of Israelites, very famous, they made this a monument of a calf, and it would just make a groaning sound. And this was a result of a century-old Egyptian influence, because in Egypt, in the town of Memphis, they have a sacred bull called Apis. And they actually used to worship, the Egyptians would worship that bull over there. And this is almost like, you know, the English term, which is like aping the master. Now they also want to do the same thing, start to worship the same kind of a calf that they saw the Egyptians worshipping. And when regret overcame them and they saw that they had gone astray, they said, if our Lord does not have mercy on us and forgive us, we shall be surely among the losers. And when Moses returned to his people angry and grieved, he said, how wretched is that which you did in my absence? Would you hasten the retribution of your Lord? And he threw down the tablets and seized his brother by the hair of his head, dragging him closer. Harun cried, O son of my mother, indeed the people overwhelmed me and almost did me to death. So let not the enemies gloat over me and do not count me among the wrongdoers. So Hazrat Harun alayhi salam, he was the elder brother of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, and he showed true maturity as an elder, you know, as a much more mature person, of how to handle his young brother when his young brother is going through a huge emotional trauma. So he doesn't react. He's very calm and he says, oh son of my mother. Look at the beautiful face, you know. He didn't take his name to say, you my younger brother. What he said, oh son of my mother, reminding that they have a tremendous relationship. Moses said, my Lord, forgive me and my brother and admit us into your mercy, for you are the most merciful of all those who show mercy. Indeed, those who took the calf for worship incurred the anger from their Lord and humiliation in the life of this world. And thus do we reward those who fabricate falsehood. And as for those who do ill deeds and later repent after them and have faith, they shall find their Lord forgiving and merciful. And when the anger subsided in Moses, he took up the tablets, and in their inscription was guidance and mercy for those who are fearful of their Lord. And Moses chose for his people 70 men for our appointment. And when the earthquake seized them, he said, my Lord, if you had willed, you could have destroyed them before and me as well. Would you destroy us for what the foolish among us have done? This is not but a trial by you, by which you send astray whom you will and guide whom you will. You are our protector, so forgive us and have mercy on us. You are the best of the forgivers. This is the attitude, I think this is the attitude when we are undergoing any fear or any threat or any trial, put your trust on Allah. Know that Allah is your truest friend. Know that He is your only protector. Be firm that He is the only helper from whom any good can be expected. And ordain for us in this world that which is good, and also in the hereafter. Indeed, we have turned back to you. He said, "My punishment I afflict with it whom I will, but my mercy encompasses all things. So I will ordain for those who fear me and give zakat, and those who believe in our verses." There's a hadith, a beautiful hadith, Prophet said, on the throne of Allah is written, Allah's mercy surpasses His anger. So be sure that Allah's mercy is much, much more than His anger. As long as we ask Him for forgiveness, His mercy will surpass any anger, anything that we may have done in the past. Allah is sure to forgive us. Now, there are two levels of Allah's mercy that Allah is describing over here. He is merciful for all believers and disbelievers in this world. So He says, my mercy encompasses all things. At the second level, His mercy, His rahmat, in the hereafter, which is attached to three conditions. And that are being described over here, iman, firm faith in Allah, taqwa, fear of Allah, and zakat. So it's almost like saying fulfilling the rights of Allah and fulfilling the rights of people. Those who follow the messenger, the unlettered prophet, whom they find written in what they have in the Torah and the gospel, who enjoin upon them what is right and forbid them what is wrong, and makes lawful for them the good things and prohibits from them the evil, and relieves them of their burden and shackles that weigh upon them. So they who believed in him, honored him, supported him, and followed the light which was sent down with him, it is those who will be successful. Shariat of Islam, as being said over here, is a lighter Shariat, much lighter than the previous one. It removes the burden that had been laid on the previous followers of Islam. But by hair splitting of the alims, by the exaggerated piety of the spiritual leaders, and by the superstition and restrictions and regulation imposed by the common man, a simple, down-to-earth religion of Islam, we find it so difficult. We have made it so difficult, exactly because of the same reason that Bani Israel did it. Say, O mankind, indeed I am a messenger of Allah to you from Him, to whom belongs the sovereignty of heavens and earth. There is no God except Him. He gives life and He causes death. So believe in Allah and His messenger, the unlettered prophet, who believes in Allah and His word, and follow Him that you may be guided. This is what we need to do. This is what we need to do. In our culture, in our worship, in our dealings, in our relationship, we need to follow Him that we may be guided. We need to follow our messenger. That's what this ayat is saying. Follow him and you will be guided. And among the people of Moses is a group which guides by truth and by it establishes justice. And we divided them into 12 descendant tribes as distinct nations. And we revealed to Moses when his people asked him for water, strike the rock with the staff, and there gush forth from it 12 springs. Every people knew its drinking place. And we shaded them with clouds and sent upon them man and salwa, saying, eat of the good things which we have provided to you. And they did not wrong us, but they only wronged themselves. So these are the 12 tribes. These are the demands of 12 tribes of Bani Israel. All tribes are actually sons of Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam. Hazrat Yaqub had 12 sons, and each one was representing one of the tribes. And they demanded to Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, we want water, and we want water independently, each tribe having its own spring. And they got their wish, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, strike this rock with your staff. Now the issue is, if people don't bless the blessing they are given by Allah, then they will actually bring a great harm upon themselves. And when it was said to them, dwell in this city and eat from it wherever you will, they said, repentance, and enter the gate bowing down humbly. We will forgive your sins and bestow abundance on the righteous. So now we look at the last ayat. فَبَدَّلَ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْهُمْ قَوْلًا غَيْرَ الَّذِي قِيلَ لَهُمْ فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ رِجْزًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ بِمَا كَانُوا يَظْلِمُونَ. But those who wronged among them changed the words to the statement other than that which had been sent to them. So we sent upon them a punishment from the sky, for they transgressed repeatedly. So what this ayat is really telling us is that this insolence and disrespect was in the behavior of Bani Israel. This had become really part of their nature. It was simmering. It was simmering all the time. At every opportune moment, this disrespect would actually flare up. This was like a disease, you know. There's a disease which is lurking inside the body. There's a virus which just sits over there, waits. And every now and then it would make an appearance. The same thing. So this is a disease, and this is a disease of heart. And this is a disease which is called hypocrisy. So barakallahu lana wa lakum fil Quranil azim wa nafana wa iyyakum bil ayati wa zikril hakim.